Contrary to the opinions of the communists, money has a moral framework underpinning it. In a very general sense, it works like this. The more money you have, the more value you have provided to other people's lives. Now, there's certainly exceptions to this rule. For example, there's many ways people provide value to each other without exchanging money, or they provide that value at a much lower rate than is the market standard, for a reason other than money. Additionally, this rule is not consistently correct at the extreme ends of the distribution, meaning the super rich and the super poor. There's absolutely ways to become rich without providing value to other people, like winning the lottery or trading in stocks, neither of which actually involve creating a product or service yourself. And obviously, the super poor still have value as human beings and to those other people that they interact with. For the vast majority of us, the more you get paid, the more people your efforts have helped. Consider this situation. You're a cobbler making shoes and you need a chair. Your friend is a carpenter making chairs and he needs a pair of shoes. Let's assume, for the sake of argument, the shoes and the chair are worth the same value at market. Well, value is relative. You don't personally value your shoes as much as the market does, because you can make shoes anytime you want. It's become quite easy for you to do. If you ever need a new pair, you can whip them up in no time flat. But you personally value the chair more than the market does, because you actually need a chair and you can't build one yourself. Your carpenter friend feels the same way. He undervalues his own chairs and overvalues your shoes relative to the market. So when you and your friend make a straight exchange of one pair of shoes for one chair, even though the market value of the items is equal, both people see an increase of value in their lives because they needed the other person's creations more than their own. This is why value is not a zero-sum game hoarded by the super rich, as the communists like to believe, but instead value is generated through honest trade. And things like hard work or innovation can generate new value. But where does the money come in? Well, money is simply a portable medium to store value. Rather than trading your shoes straight across for other objects you might need every single time, and therefore only being able to trade the shoes, and so likely only making the shoes, when you need something in that moment, money allows you to trade many shoes right away, hold on to the value in a portable form, and then spend that value at a later date for something that you need. Money simplifies the bartering process by allowing you to defer the reward of your shoe creation to a later date. And it also allows you to store up the results of successfully trading your shoes for later, when you may actually need it more than you do now. Money is essentially a more sophisticated version of the squirrel storing nuts away for winter, which is probably why that euphemism is so commonly used to describe the practice. So, if money is simply a representation of how much work you've performed in the service of other people, then money can be used as a general measurement of how many other people you've helped. This is the morality of money. If your cobbler business is successful, then you've spent a lot of your time and effort creating many pairs of shoes. Many people are wearing those shoes and have had their lives measurably improved as a result of your efforts. And the money you've got in the bank is a symbol of how much you've done for them. Meanwhile, if your carpenter friend is actually a shoddy carpenter, he won't be selling as many chairs. He'll have less money, and he will have improved the lives of less people. Let's talk about a modern example. This idea is the answer to why an athlete or an actor makes significantly more money than a teacher. A teacher may provide a significantly more important service than the simple entertainment of an actor, but how many people will each of them impact? A famous entertainer will reach millions of people over the course of their career, but a teacher with a class size of 50 students every year during a 40-year career will only teach 2,000 people. Even though the service the teacher provides is significantly more important, the sheer volume of the people the entertainer impacts more than makes up for their diminished individual impact in terms of total value added to people's lives. And so, they get paid more. This is also, by the way, why unsuccessful sports stars or actors make far less than teachers. Which then brings us to the joy and the curse of mass market appeal. Niche products, by design, help fewer people, and therefore demand a high price, simply because the creators of those products would not make enough money to survive selling them at a lower price. There's just not enough customers to go around. Meanwhile, if something has mass market appeal, you can sacrifice nearly everything and still get quite rich, as we've seen by literally everyone pandering to the Chinese market right now. The principle still applies. Yes, if you tweak things a bit, your product quality goes down, and individual people have less value added to their lives as a result of your work. But if that same tweak opens up a new market with millions of new customers, that loss in individual value is more than made up for by the new value you're bringing to millions of new people. And that's reflected in the profits. Now, we can argue whether or not it's actually good for companies to abandon their domestic markets and chase the overseas dollar in a bid to provide value to the people of that new market. There's very good arguments against that practice, and that's probably a place for sensible government regulation through tariffs and whatnot. But that's not the point. The point of the video is to discuss how money has a moral underpinning. How having more money means that you probably helped more people through your own efforts. I've listened to a number of self-made CEOs give speeches about how to expand a business. I've listened to motivational speakers. I've listened to graduation and commencement speeches at universities. I've even listened to a lot of everyone's favorite Canadian psychologist, Frogman. And what they've all got in common is that they describe their business not as a business, nor as a way to make money, and not even as a career, though they still admit it's all those things. They describe it primarily as a service, and themselves as servants. Maybe that's just them making themselves look good in the public eye. That's probably a good chunk of it, in fact. But I still choose to believe that it is at least partially because they understand that money is ultimately meaningless if it does not represent the good that you do for other people. This is why most rich capitalists don't actually keep their money locked away in a vault, so they can go for a swim Scrooge McDuck style every once in a while. Most of them run foundations where they can perform charitable work. Most of them are venture capitalists, seeing the value in other people's innovations and choosing to give them a leg up. Most of their wealth isn't even in money at all. In fact, the actual medium of money itself doesn't even matter. For example, people don't covet gold for any of gold's innate properties. It's just that gold is rare, and it couldn't be artificially produced in large quantities for almost all of human history. So, as a general rule, if you had a gold coin, either you mined the ore out of the earth yourself and minted it, which was labor in its own right, or at some point you exchanged your labor for that coin and were therefore entitled to its fruits. The fact that we use paper money now, or electronic money, doesn't change this paradigm. But that's the core problem the communists have with this system: exchanging labor for money. The communists believe that two people choosing to exchange labor for money is inherently exploitative, because the person choosing to spend their labor isn't making a real choice. They're driven by the biological necessities of needing to pay for food and shelter, and the person choosing to spend their money is exploiting the other person for their labor. They don't believe that two people making a voluntary exchange are increasing each other's value, like the cobbler and the carpenter, but that if any exchange is based in the necessity of a party, it can only be exploitative. Their competing idea is the labor theory of value, which basically states that if a person's labor is added to a commodity, the commodity's value increases. In reality, this is obviously not true. For example, you can buy the ingredients for a meal, foul up the cooking of the meal because you're a terrible cook, and produce a meal with less value than the individual ingredients you started with. But under communism, there is a strange quasi-worship of the worker as a mythical figure. And so all labor, no matter its quality, must add value to a commodity in order for it to be a non-exploitative exchange. And when difference in quality becomes the issue, then quality as a concept must be removed from the equation entirely. This is why a lot of people refer to communism as a great equalization, or a lowering everyone down to the common denominator. Because while you can't force untalented people to have talent, you can force talented people to be untalented, or at least not fully utilize those talents. And more often than not, the communists did this through blood. Every communist society inevitably collapsed because its economy could no longer function. Everyone was expected to produce the same work, as they believed human beings were a blank slate, and everything from inclination to talent to aptitude to intelligence was simply a product of socialization. The least productive members of society were simultaneously praised as the proletariat and whipped to work as hard as they could lest they waste the people's labor. And the most productive members of society either lowered themselves voluntarily in order to survive or were lowered forcefully by the state, some of them through systematic abuse that destroyed their ability to produce, some of them through their slaughter, under the guise of them being the bourgeoisie. And so, with nobody left to perform exceptional or innovative work, and with everyone else's work valued the same regardless of quality, the communist society always collapses under the weight of its own failure. Because if the least productive worker is valued as much as the most productive worker, why wouldn't you just take it easy? As I said earlier, this society-wide catastrophe stems from the belief that two people exchanging labor for money is inherently exploitative due to the underlying motivations of necessity on the part of the worker. But the communist doesn't understand that necessity is not a function of capitalism, but a function of reality. The communist believes that necessity would not exist under communism. No, seriously. I've been arguing with a lot of commies on Twitter this past week, and one of them even said, "We don't need money if we all just keep our labor and have no use for it." And in response to my desire to save up for a rainy day, said, "What rainy day?" They believe the problems of the world are an exclusive function of capitalism, and the great equalization will lead to paradise on earth, where there are no more rainy days to save up for. They don't understand that money isn't some kind of magical force wielded by the rich against the poor. They don't understand that while exploitation does exist, there are certainly rich people who became rich without exploitation. And they don't understand that a person with a lot of money, who earned it all fairly, is not inherently immoral simply for having money. That's why the communists had to define two people consenting to exchange labor for money as inherently exploitative. Even as they tout the primacy of consent in other political discussions, when it comes to money, consent is just not enough. To them, the working man cannot consent, in the same way that a child cannot consent. And the working man must be protected and shepherded like a child is. It's why they scold working-class people who are capitalists as bootlickers or traitors, in much the same way that a parent would scold a child. They rattle on about rich old men, not understanding that the reason old people are disproportionately rich is because they've had approximately 50 more years of stored-up labor under their belts. They've had 50 more years to actually do work. In the end, communism is simply an excuse to justify their desire to steal labor from people who spent years earning it. And you know, if you want a little bit of hypocritical fun, go look up the old tweets of Bernie Sanders. He used to talk about the exploitation of the millionaires and billionaires, until he himself became a millionaire in 2016. Now it's all just the billionaires. This is how it always happens. Those who believe capitalism is inherently exploitative, while simultaneously still climbing its rungs, will adjust their framework such that they are still the poor, and the 1% still prefers anybody more rich than they are, even as their own wealth grows. I am happy to argue in defense of capitalism, even though I am poor myself, because I understand the morality of money. I understand that, a handful of notable exceptions notwithstanding, those people who have more money than me have added more value to the lives of more people than I have. And if society were restructured in such a way that those people would no longer be allowed to add value to the lives of other people, all of us, rich and poor, young and old, would suffer tremendously because of it. The worst thing a civilization can do is to tell its most exceptional people, we will no longer reward you for your talents, your skills, your education, or your hard work. It's better to pay them than to lose them.